السلام عليكم، يسعد مساءكم جميعا، and welcome to our today's workshop. It's a very important topic, very important workshop. The topic here is transitions and connections in academic writing, presented by Mr. Yahya Alghamdi. Thank you, brother Yahya, for taking the lead to present this very important workshop. So the floor is yours. You may start now.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bassem, and welcome everyone on our workshop today, which is about transitions and connections in academic writing. Let's start. So here are a few objectives that I'm expecting all of you to be able to know after the end of this presentation, inshallah. So we will look at the meaning of transition words, and also you will learn how to and when and how to use transition words. Also, you will learn the types of sentences and you will understand different types of transition words. Also, you will learn how to apply transition words in academic writing, which is our basic focus today. And before we end, we will have some review of the most common mistakes in using transition words in academic writing. Finally, I'll give you the chance to do some practices on some activities about transition words and their uses. All right, so let's look at what transition words mean. So transition words and phrases also can be called conjunctions, linking words, etc., are used to link different ideas together in a text. They express the relationship between different sentences or patterns of the sentence. Also known as linking, as I said, connecting words or conjunctions. So whatever the term is, all have the same purpose, which is linking different ideas together. Here is an example. Just look at this example for half a minute. And as you can see, there are three linking words here. Therefore, however, and also. Each one of them links the following sentence to the previous one. It links the ideas together to make a logical flow of ideas and also to make our thoughts meaningful for the readers. So the proposed solution to the problem didn't work. Therefore, when I use therefore, I mean that there is something that results from what I've just discussed here. So therefore, we attempted another one. Why? Because the first solution didn't work. Okay. However, here I'm taking the direction of my sentence to an opposite way, which says that this solution was also unsuccessful. So also the second solution that I have used, okay, or that was used, okay, to solve this problem, it also didn't work. And here I added the word also because we have two solutions here we mentioned in the text. The first solution and the other one. So both didn't work. So imagine that there are no transition words here. Let's read it again and see. The proposed solution to the problem didn't work. We attempted another one. This solution was also unsuccessful. So when I say this solution, the reader might not understand if I mean the first solution or the second one. So here it comes the importance of making appropriate transition words or linking words. So before we dig deeply on the types of conjunctions or linking words, let's first have a very quick look on the four types of sentences in English. Okay, there are four main types of sentences in English. Okay, A sentence means that it is a group of words and expresses a complete thought. So this is what a simple meaning of a sentence is. So the four types are simple sentence, compound sentence, complex sentence, and the most complicated one is called compound complex or complex compound sentence. And we will look at each of those and find out what are the differences and how they are working. So let's start with those simple sentences. So in English, a simple sentence contains only one clause and independent clause. So this one clause is known as independent clause. What is an independent clause, or what is a clause in general? A clause is a group of words that includes a subject and a verb. Okay, so a subject and a verb are the main parts in an English sentence. Okay, so examples here, we could have a clause with a subject and a verb. Like for example, she runs to the meeting. So she here is the subject, is the doer of the action, and runs is the verb. Okay, and what comes after is called a predicate. A predicate could be an object, could be a noun phrase, okay? So the main things that we have to focus and make sure that we have in our sentences is to have a subject and a verb. These are the basics. Another way to make simple sentences is by having a subject, a verb, and an object. And an example of that is, she runs the meeting. Look at the differences between those two sentences. Here we say she runs something. What is this thing that she runs? Is the meeting. Okay, so she is the leader of the meeting. She is the one who performs the meeting. Okay, so the meeting here is an object. We call it an object, which could be in a form of a predicate. Another way is to have a subject and verb plus a subject complement. What is a subject complement here? Let's look at an example. We have Ali is happy. Look, the difference here is that we have a main verb here that gives a meaning. But here we have a verb be, or we call it a helping verb. Ali is happy. Happy here is an adjective. So an adjective is called a subject complement. We are trying to describe what Ali is, what is the situation that he is in at the time of speaking. So he is happy, okay? Another way could be a subject plus verb, and the object could be in two different ways, okay? Sometimes it is an indirect object plus a direct object, or it could be like this one, okay? An indirect object example is like this one. She made me a pie. Okay, so she made a pie for me. So this is the object, the pie. When we look at the second example here, she made a pie. So this is what is more important for me and for the listener, is to tell them what she made. Okay, but this one is a compliment. I just want to describe that this pie was made for me. Okay, and here, me becomes a compliment while it is here an indirect object. Okay, it usually comes or always comes after the verb immediately. So it is more important for me to tell the listener that this pie was made specifically for me. Okay. So how to say the sentence or how to perform a sentence depends on the speaker himself and what he wants to convey, what is more important for him to convey for the listeners, okay? Another one here, we have a subject plus verb plus object complement, okay? And this is the example, they made him happy. We cannot say they made happy like this one, she made a pie. It's totally different. Here I'm making just a compliment for this person, for the object itself. I'm not making a compliment for the subject. Okay, so this doesn't stand without having him here in the sentence. So they made him happy. Okay, so these are just some examples of how to make simple sentences in English. And as you can see, all the examples here, all the ways that we performed or made simple sentences, all of them have subject and a verb. Okay, the only difference is what comes after that. Let's move to the other slide here. An independent clause, which I have mentioned on the previous one. First, we talked about a clause, and here we are talking about an independent clause. What is it? And it's described or can be simplified as IC, independent clause, okay? Or we call it sometimes a main clause, has a subject and a verb, okay? So have this always in mind, that an independent clause always has a subject and a verb. For example, okay, let's look at these before we go to the example. It can stand alone as a complete simple sentence. Okay, so those independent clauses gives a full meaning, a full thought. They transfers a full meaning, okay? So they stand alone, okay, in our sentences. While a dependent clause, the other example or the other type of clauses is a dependent clause, and we refer to this as a DC, dependent clause, is not a complete sentence. It doesn't give us any meaning, okay? It doesn't stand alone, but it is embedded inside another clause, okay? So we use those dependent clauses, okay, just to explain something, okay? But they never make a full meaning. The only full meaning is made only by an independent clause. So let's look at these two examples here, okay? And I have made descriptions of each of those parts of the sentence with those acronyms. So the first one, he achieved his goal. So this is an independent clause. And as you can see, it gives a meaning. There is a subject, and there is a verb, and an object. Okay, he achieved his goal. That, here I use the conjunction, okay, because I have something else to say, that he was striving for. So someone, which is this person, was striving for something, was trying to achieve something, which is his goal. It took him very long time. And suddenly he achieved his goal that he was striving for. So I made a connection here between this independent clause and this dependent clause. And as you can see, this doesn't give a meaning. He was striving for. What he was striving for what? So this doesn't make any meaning, okay? We just add it, okay, as a complement to the previous sentence. And here I used a connection. Okay, a relative pronoun to connect those two sentences together. So another example here, in the backyard, comma, the boy was screaming. So where is the dependent clause and where is the independent clause? I want to see your participations in the chat box. So where's the dependent clause? Is it the first or the second one? The dependent clause, the DC. Where is the DC, the dependent clause? The one that doesn't give us meaning. The one that doesn't give any meaning. When you read it, you don't know anything. Yes, exactly. So it's the first one. So in the backyard, when I say in the backyard, what's in the backyard? I can't understand anything from this one. But here, when I say the boy was screaming, so this gives me an idea. This gives me a meaning. Okay, so here I just added this dependent clause, okay, to describe the place where the boy was screaming. So he was screaming in the backyard. So I can also switch those two clauses by saying the boy was screaming in the backyard without having a comma. Okay, if the dependent clause comes at the beginning, we should, okay, separate those two clauses with a comma. Like, for example, when I say yesterday night, I was watching the TV. So yesterday night is a dependent clause. I was watching a TV is the independent clause. Very good. Okay, let's move to the next one, a compound sentence. What's a compound sentence here? A compound sentence is a little bit, okay, sometimes it could be longer than a simple sentence. We are trying to join two clauses. So let's see what it means. A compound sentence has two or more independent clauses. Two or more independent clauses. So there is no dependent clause here. Okay, both sentences have meaning, but they are related to each other. That's why we need to put them together by connecting them with a conjunction or a linking word. So there is no dependent clause, as I've said. Okay, you have to keep this in mind. Okay. Also, clauses are linked by a comma followed by a conjunction. Okay, like those conjunctions that we have. For, and, nor, but, or, yet, and so. And this has a famous acronym, which is FAN BOYS. F from for, A from and, N from nor, B from but, O from or, Y from yet, and S from so. Try to memorize it in this way. Okay, so these conjunctions or linking words connect two independent clauses to make compound sentences. Let's look at these two examples. I started my classes on time. So this is an independent clause. And here I have another one. I arrived late. Okay. This is also an independent clause. It's IC, but this was a mistake. So IC and IC here. Okay. This is the conjunction. And look that we have put a comma here. Okay. So I want to say that I started my classes on time, but I arrived late. So I still had the chance to arrive to my classes on time, even though I arrived late. The second one, the sun was shining. This is also an independent clause. And I connected the other sentence, everyone was happy, with the word and. Okay, so but here gives us opposite sentences or opposing meanings. They are not the same, but they are related to each other. But here we use and to connect two, okay, relevant sentences, okay, which are different than those we use with but. So the sun was shining and everyone was happy. We cannot say, but everyone was happy. We should say, but everyone was unhappy, if I'm using but here. Sometimes I'll give you an example here in the chat box. I might use and but for simple sentences like, I did my test and succeeded. Why I didn't use a comma here, like those two things? This is a simple sentence because the subject, okay, I did my test and succeeded. So I succeeded and did my test. When the subject for both verbs or the both words are the same, it has the same subject, so I don't use a comma here. And this becomes a simple sentence. But here, okay, although I use the same subject, but I'm having different thoughts here, different meanings, okay, which are related to each other. Here I'm having the sun and everyone, different subjects, okay? Let's look at the other type, which is complex sentences. A complex sentence here has at least one independent clause and one or more dependent clauses. Look how it becomes a little bit complicated. So it has one independent clause. This is something necessary, at least. So it could have more than two independent clauses and one or more dependent clauses. Okay, so this is different from the compound sentences by adding the dependent clauses. An independent clause starts with a conjunction, like for example, after, although, unless, because, in order, if, when, and that. Okay, so we should start with those conjunctions followed by a comma. Okay, then we put the dependent clause, okay, and then an independent clause to make a full meaning. So let's look at those two examples here to understand what it means. When I move to another city, so here I started with a conjunction, when. When I move to another city, this is a dependent clause. It doesn't give a meaning. Okay, what happened when I moved to another city, comma, after I got a job promotion. So I inserted another dependent clause to describe, okay, the what of the sentence that I would like to convey. So when I moved to another city, after I got a job promotion. So this one comes between two commas, okay? I had to spend a month to discover the whole city. So we can remove this dependent clause and we will still have a meaningful sentence. So when I moved to another city, I had to spend a month to discover the whole city. It gives us a meaning, but here I added this one, okay? I inserted this dependent clause to describe something, to tell the people why I moved to another city. What was the reason, okay? The reason was I got a job promotion. So here we have to follow a rule, which is to put this dependent clause, okay, between two commas. It is wrong to put them in just one sentence without making any commas here, okay? So one dependent clause, another dependent clause, and finally an independent clause. And here is a conjunction at the beginning and a conjunction at the beginning of this dependent clause. So each dependent clause has a conjunction, okay? Another example, the company that started last month is hiring new workers this month. Okay, sorry. So the company is hiring new workers this month. So here I just inserted this dependent clause to describe which company I'm talking about, which is the one that started last month. So here I added a conjunction. Okay, so two dependent clauses and one independent clause. So the company is hiring new workers this month. This acts as an independent clause. Okay, the whole sentence, the company and this one is an independent clause and I inserted one dependent clause. Okay. هذه تسمى باللغة العربية الجمل الاعتراضية. When we insert something to describe something or to show something, but we usually have to use a conjunction here to connect those words or those sentences together. The last one, he went to see a doctor. Why? Because he was sick. So two independent clauses. Okay. And I joined them with a conjunction. Okay. To show a reason. Why did he go to the doctor? Because he was sick. So as you can see, this is still small or short sentence, but it is a complex one. Okay. All right. The last type here is compound complex sentences. So we have a compound and a complex sentence, okay, connected together to form a full thought or a full meaning. So it has two or more independent clauses, the full meaningful sentences, and one or more dependent clauses joined by a conjunction. Okay, so a conjunction here or a linking word is very important to join those, okay, clauses. So let's look at an example. I have never been good at English writing. So this is an independent clause, okay? But conjunction, because I needed to improve my writing, what happened? I have spent a lot of time studying sentence structure. It's a little bit complicated, but by the use of those linking words, it made it easier for us to understand. Okay, so I have never been good at English writing. This is, okay, an independent clause. It gives us a meaningful sentence, okay, a meaningful thought. Here, I wanted to say, but, okay, because I needed to improve my writing. Look, I used but and because here. I needed to improve my writing. What happened? So this is the thing that helped me become good at English. Okay, I have spent a lot of time studying sentence structure. Another example, after our shift was over. So here is a conjunction with a dependent clause, comma, Jeremy and I cleaned the glass cases while Lisa and Anne counted the drawers. So two actions taking place at the same time. So after our shift was over, okay, this is something in the past. Jeremy and I cleaned the glass cases, okay, while at the same time, Lisa and Anne counted the drawers. So those two actions took place at the same time after our shift was over. Here I use the semicolon because I'm connecting, okay, additional details related to the same thought. Okay, so here I added the word since as a linking word. Everyone worked together. We got to leave early. So all of them are related, are connected to the same thought, okay? Since here is used to make a reason, like for example, because, it's the same as the word because. So because everyone worked together, who, when I'm talking about everyone, Jeremy and I, Lisa and Anne, okay? We worked together, we got to leave early. This is what happened, okay? This is also an independent clause. So as you can see, one, two, three dependent clauses, okay? As I have said here, one or more dependent clauses, okay, joined by conjunction, which is this one, okay, and this one, and followed by an independent clause. So we have two dependent independent clauses, okay? So it takes time to move from forming simple sentences until to reach this point of forming compound complex sentences. This is a little bit advanced, but it's not that difficult. You need to go step by step. If you want to improve your English language structures, how to write meaningful and correct sentence forms, you have to go from simple sentences, okay, step by step until you get to compound complex sentences, okay? And if you know how these sentences, if you can comprehend these sentences, this will make it easier for you to comprehend, okay, long text academic writing, and also will help you to write also in English. All right, so after we finished from learning about simple sentences, let's look here at when do we need to use those transition words. Okay, so transition words commonly appear at the beginning of a new sentence or clause followed by a comma. Okay, so if I'm, for some of those conjunctions or linking words, we have to have a comma, as we will see on the following sentences. Also, this expresses how this clause relates to the previous one. So transition words or transition phrases could also be phrases. It's not only words, okay? And we will look at additional examples as we move on. All of them connect one sentence to a previous one, okay? And each of those transition words or phrases, okay, gives us, the readers, an idea about what the writer wants to tell us, okay? So they should be used, okay, in a correct way. Otherwise, the reader will be misleading. It will not be understood, okay? You will not be able to convey what you really or exactly want to convey. So here is an example. There is a lack of reliable data to establish a clear relationship between these variables. Okay, this is an academic sentence or academic style of a sentence. We ended this one. Okay, this is an independent clause. We added a conjunction. Nevertheless, it has been argued that a relationship does exist. Okay. So even though, although there is a lack of reliable data, okay, it has been argued that a relationship does exist with something, okay, other than those data and the relationship between these variables. There is something else that told them or gave us information that, okay, the relationship already exists. So this is one of the conjunctions or linking words that we use at the beginning of an independent clause followed by a comma, okay? And this is called an adverbial clause, okay? Transition words can also appear in the middle of a clause. How? It is important to place them correctly to convey the meaning you intend. So this one gives us another way of using the word nevertheless, okay, in the middle of a sentence or a clause. So it has nevertheless been argued that a relationship does exist, which gave us the same meaning as the second part of this sentence or this thought, okay? Because we have two sentences here. So it has the same meaning, but different way of writing them. So either you can start with the conjunction followed by a comma, or put the conjunction after the verb like this. It has been argued that a relationship does exist. It has nevertheless, okay? And I think you have seen lots of those examples in academic writing where a writer doesn't start his sentence with a conjunction. He put it after several words from the beginning. Sometimes they put a comma, or they separate this conjunction with two commas, and sometimes it's okay to have it like this. So whether you use a comma, two commas, or not, it is also acceptable, okay? As long as you know exactly where you are placing those conjunctions. Okay, so it's very important to know the place, okay, and the type of conjunction you are using to convey your meaning. So let's look at some examples of text with and without transition words and see how they are different. So the text below describes all the events it needs. The events are in the text, okay, but it doesn't use any transition words to connect them. So take a minute, okay, try to digest this, okay, paragraph. Okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sentences. Try to read it and understand what it means and see without using conjunction, will you be able to understand or comprehend what it means? Share me your thoughts in the chat box. I'll try to watch in the chat box. If it's possible for you to understand, okay, the whole idea or not. So I'll try to read it with you. Germany invaded Poland on September 1st, 1939. France and the United Kingdom declared war on Germany. The Soviet Union worked with Germany. The partitioned Poland in 1941. Germany invaded the Soviet Union. Look, when I read this one, when I came to this one, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense at all, okay? They partitioned Poland. Are they the United Kingdom and Germany and France and the Soviet Union, all of them together? Or is it two of them or what? So this doesn't give us any clear message. We don't know exactly what the writer wants to convey, but let's look at the sentence again after those conjunctions or transition words have been added. So read it again and tell me your thoughts. Just to give you a meaning about these transition words, consequently gives us a result of what happened here, okay? Initially, something that started, okay? Started before something. In order to, this gives us, where's the mouse? Okay. So with Germany, in order to partition Poland. So this is a result. Why do they want to do something? In order to do something else. Okay. However, so here I'm moving to a different thought. Okay. Germany invaded the Soviet Union in 1941. So now it's very clear. Exactly. it is very clear, okay? Even though, okay, or if you didn't use the correct or the exact conjunctions, you will still, okay, make it difficult for the reader to digest your idea or to understand exactly what you want to convey. So put in mind two things. First of all, you have to understand what each of those conjunctions really mean, okay? You have also you should understand, okay, when to use each of those conjunctions, okay, and what is the structure that each of those conjunctions should be used in. Okay, there are lots of linking words, okay, that could be used interchangeably. What does interchangeably here mean? It means that both could be used at the same time and give us the same meaning, but some of them may not. So please try to make sure that those words or those linking words, okay, are used effectively to transfer your meaningful idea to the listener or to the reader in a better way, okay? And sometimes I always try to inform my students or to let them know that if you would like to understand that your sentence was written in a good way, try to read it again. Read it again as a reader, not as a writer. And try to find out if it's really, okay, tells what you are trying to say or not. This is one of the most important steps, okay, for editing. When you want to edit your writing, you have to read again what you have written. Read it from an eye of a reader, not from the eye of a writer. Exactly, what the knowing of the transition words meaning helps in using these words effectively. Yes, I totally agree with you. Okay, so these words, okay, I've written their meanings here. So for example, consequently expresses a consequence, okay, which is a result. Because Germany invaded Poland, okay, Germany invaded Poland, because of that, France and the UK declared war on Germany, okay? Initially expresses a time limit. At first, it means at first, the Soviet Union worked with Germany, okay? So I replaced initially with at first here, which has the same meaning, okay? But we will see in the next sentence that this didn't continue, okay? So we used in order to link an action with a goal. An action with a goal. What action was taken and what was the goal? What they wanted to do, what they wanted to achieve. So the two countries worked together to partition Poland, okay, to separate Poland, okay? However, expresses a conflict here. Although they initially worked together, okay, what happened? Germany eventually betrayed the Soviet Union. This is how these sentences, okay, are explained. All right, let's move to another slide here. This is an advice that do not overuse transition words. Do not overuse them. Transition words are essential to clear writing, but we shouldn't use too many of them. Okay, overusing linking words slows down the text and makes it feel repetitive. Okay, sometimes I read my students' writing and I see that they are overusing those conjunctions. Okay, They use, however, more than 3 or 4 times in one paragraph, which really just repeats what they have written before. So try to use a variety of them. Try to use something new. Try to play with the language, okay? But when you do so, try to make sure that you are, okay, having a good grasp of what you want to say, okay? Try to understand exactly that each of those words that you are using, okay, will give the reader an idea about what you are trying to say. And this is what comes, okay, as a revision to what you have written, just to make sure that everything looks fine. So let's read this example here. The first experiment yielded a positive result. Okay, however, okay, the second experiment yielded a negative result. So these are two negative sentences. That's fine until this time, okay? Nonetheless, the third experiment yielded a positive result, whereas the fourth experiment yielded another negative result. So what do you think about this sentence? It's a little bit misleading. It's repetitive, you know? It's kind of, you know, trying to make a run on sentences that, okay, describes the same thing, okay, but in a way that is boring. It's a little bit boring, okay? So how can we fix this, okay, paragraph or this piece of writing, okay? We have to join similar ideas together to have one linking word. So just one linking word will, okay, solve all these problems here. So let's look at the result. So this is the edited sentence. The first and third experiment, the first one and the third one, because they have positive results. So I'm grouping them now in one sentence. Okay, so I don't want to separate them in two different sentences because they have the same meaning. They ended up with the same positive results. Okay, so the first and third experiments yielded positive results, comma, while the outcomes or the results of the second and fourth experiments were negative. So the second is a negative one, has negative results, and also the fourth, okay, resulted in a negative ones. Okay, so I grouped them together. I made grouping to ideas that have the same thought, okay, or that have the same style, okay? And look, it becomes very smooth, shorter, and easy to understand. Okay, so writing here, sometimes it needs, you know, it needs smart people to play with the language, okay? You have to write in the same way that you like people or that you like to read other people's writing, okay? When you write, sometimes when you read to others, you can't stop, you just keep reading. This is how it, okay, it comes like a smart way of dealing with the language, just to make it more interesting for the readers, okay, to continue or to read further. And this takes time, but it's not impossible, as I've said, it needs just practice. It needs only practice. Types and examples of transition words. Okay, there are 4 main types of transition words. We have additive, when we add information, contrasts, when we make 2 opposing views or 2 opposite details. We have causal effect, and this is one of the most tricky, okay, things that I find most of my students make mistakes when using them, okay? And finally, a sequential, when you try to okay, list ideas or details. So remember that transition words with similar meanings, okay, are not necessarily interchangeable. And I have already explained that. Okay, so sometimes we might have two words that gives us opposing meaning, but they might not, you know, give the same, okay, meaning that you would like to say. So be careful when you try to use those transition words. Also, it's important to understand the meaning of all the transition words you use. Okay, because this will help you, okay, use the one that really describes your thought in a clear way. The last thing, if unsure, sometimes we might seem unsure if what we have chosen is the best one or not. Try to consult a dictionary to find the practice, the precise definition. Okay, even for us, okay, advanced writers, even for native speakers, you find them sometimes look for, okay, phrases and conjunctions just to make sure that what they have used is the one that they really need. Okay, it's not a bad idea to ask someone, okay, who is knowledgeable or who's good in English about what you want to use, or whether you what you want to use is the one that best describes your thought or not. Okay, let's look at those conjunctions that we use to express addition when we want to add details. Okay, there are lots, huge amount of those, okay, words, but each one of them has specific function. Okay, not all the addition conjunctions are used interchangeably, as I have said. So we use them to add or introduce new information or examples. Okay, you know, I want to add something new. We also use them to expand upon, compare with, or clarify the previous text. Okay, so these four functions can be used with conjunctions that are used to add information. Okay, so adding details, expanding details, referring to previous information, comparing with previous information, and finally making clarifications.
عفوا دكتور عفوا على المقاطعة بس في كاميرا شغالة ممكن بالخطأ.
Where is it?
عند أحد الحضور في كاميرا شغالة بالخطأ.
Could you please switch off all your cams, guys? Thank you so much for letting
Welcome.
Us know.
Welcome.
So these are the functions that we can use for the conjunctions that we use to express addition, okay? An example of the first one, we found that the mixture was effective. Moreover, okay, so I'm adding something new, but it's related to the previous thought. Moreover, it appeared, look, when I used it, this is also a kind of a linking word, okay? I'm linking this one, this sentence, okay, to the mixture. So it appeared to have additional effects we hadn't predicted, okay? So pronouns also plays a good role of linking ideas and thoughts in a text. And these are some of the examples that you can use, okay, if you want to make, or if you want to add more details. Expanding details, when you want to expand, to stretch your information. An example here, several researchers have previously explored the topic. For instance, so here I'm giving an example to expand on what I have said, just to make it clear for the reader, okay? So examples here plays a good role to explain your thoughts, especially when you are talking about something abstract. So for instance, or for example, comma, Smith in 2014 examined the effects of, okay, and so on. And these are the example of transition words or phrases that we can use, okay, to expand our details. We can use such as, like, particularly, etc. Okay. And each of them has a particular way, okay, to use it, to use them. So we, it's good idea to understand how they are used in a text, so you can use them wisely. Also, referring to previous information, when you want to make a reference to something that you have written. An example here, the solution showed a high degree of absorption. Considering this result, okay, it is reasonable to conclude that. So based on this result that I have just mentioned, so I'm referring to something, okay, I just wrote. It is reasonable to conclude that, and then we complete our sentence. So here we can use considering something as for X. So I refer to X with something that I have mentioned. I'm trying to read your chats. Okay. Whereas we use whereas, Sarah. Okay. Whereas we will look at this, okay, in the following slides. Don't be in a hurry. You will find all these information, okay, in the slides. And also I will try to post a PDF of the slides so you can look at them later on. Okay, the other function, comparing with previous information. So we want to make comparisons, okay? It wasn't possible to establish a correlation between these variables, okay? Similarly, which is the same way, okay, in the same line, the connection between X and Y remains unclear. So I'm trying to make a comparison between two things. Either I'm using words like similarly to show that both of them, okay, have the same idea, or I can use in the same way, by the same token, in like manner, equally or likewise. So these are words that shows, okay, similarities between two, okay, sentences, which is connected to the same idea. Finally, making clarifications. When you want to clarify something, to describe or to explain something, okay, the patient suffered several side effects, okay, namely increased appetite. So these are one of those side effects that the patient suffered from, based on a medicine, for example, he took. Decreased libido and disordered sleep. So these are, okay, medical terms, okay, that describes the side effects that this patient suffered from. Okay, so I use the word namely here just to mention or to make something clear. What am I trying to say? What kind of side effects? Okay, this is particularly increase and in his appetite. So other examples, like that is to say, namely, specifically, sometimes, okay, is used as one of the highest frequency words in this line. More precisely, okay, in other words, just to say something in different way, you are trying to describe the same thing, but in different words. Next, we have expressing contrast. When we want to make contrasting, okay, between two ideas, the transition words always signal a contrast between two ideas. So opposing, I'm trying to make two things opposite to each other. We use them to introduce information that disagrees or contrasts with the previous text. Okay, but it's still connected in some way. So sometimes we use them within the paragraph itself or across two paragraphs. So one paragraph, okay, has information that are opposite from the one that I have already written. So I use one of those conjunctions at the beginning of the second paragraph. Okay, just to say or to tell the reader that this is something different from what I have or opposite from what I have written. So here we have lots of functions. We have five functions for contrasting: disagreement, emphasis, concession, dismissal, and replacement. You need to understand those terms and know exactly what do they mean and what type of transition words and phrases you can use. Okay, example of the disagreement is the novel does deal with the theme of the family or of family. However, its central theme is more broadly political. So those two ideas are opposing to each other. They are not the same. Okay. And these are other examples that I can use. On the other hand, like we have seen in the other hand here. In other words, or in other ways, but here on the other hand, okay, on the other way. So something that is a little bit different from what I have mentioned. However, although conversely, in contrast, equally, while, contrast, etc. Okay, this is whereas, the one who was asking about the word whereas. So it is used, okay, to describe disagreement. And we use it like this way. Put the word followed by a comma, okay, just to tell the reader that you are talking about something opposite. An emphasis, when you want to make an emphasis on something, okay, the chemical is generally thought to have corrosive properties. Indeed, okay, several studies have supported this hypothesis. So here I'm emphasizing on this thought, okay? I'm telling that several studies have supported this hypothesis. So here we can use more or most importantly, above all or indeed, okay? So this one summarizes what I have said. A concession like this one, Jones 2011 argues that the novel reflects Russian politics of the time. Although cannot stand alone in one sentence, and look how it is written. Look at the structure of this, okay, phrase. Although this is correct, other aspects of the text must also be considered. So we have two, okay, clauses here. A dependent clause and independent clause. Other aspects of the text must also be considered. This is an independent one, but this one is a dependent one, okay? If you still remember those complex sentences. Here we can use, okay, examples or samples of those conjunctions that can be used for concession, okay? Yes, it could be. I'm trying to answer Fatima Suikat. A concession, like the word although, okay, is used to give two different ideas. There is a contrast in the meaning. Although something happened, okay, there is something else, okay, resulted. So Jones argues that the novel reflects Russian politics of the time. Although this is correct, okay, other aspects of the text must also be considered. Okay. Does it seem clear? And emphasis as well, with indeed, okay, is something that we use to put all, okay, or to try to summarize all the information we have said in something simple like this. So several studies have supported this hypothesis. Okay. In other words, or above all. Okay. So it gives us a contrast information. Dismissal, like for example, it remains unclear which of these hypotheses is correct. In any case, it can be inferred that, so in any case, tells us that, okay, that in any of the cases that we used, okay, to make those hypotheses looks true, okay? In any case, it can be inferred that, so whatever we used. So whatever the case, regardless, either way, in any or either case, at any rate, or all the same, okay, are other words that can be used for dismissals. Okay, and finally, a replacement. When we want to replace, okay, an idea with another one, which has the same meaning, the character of Godfrey is often viewed as selfish, or at least self-absorbed. Okay. We can also use if not, or at least, rather, or rather, instead. Okay. So these are used also for expressing contrasts. Expressing causal effect relationships. Okay. A causal effect transition words are used to describe cause and effect. So there is something that happened which resulted in something else, or something has, okay, an effect on another thing. So let's try to look at some examples to understand what they mean and how we can use transition words to describe them. They can be used to express a purpose, a consequence, and the condition. Okay, so these are the three functions for causal effect relationships. The first one, we use accurate recording equipment so that, so what's the main point from using them? So that our results would be as precise as possible. So where's the cause here? And where's the effect? Who can tell me in the chat box? Where is the cause and where is the effect? The effect is the result, just to make it clear. Effect is the same as result. So there's something that happened at the beginning, which caused something to happen next. So where's the effect and where's the result in this sentence? Sorry, the cause and the effect, the cause and the result. Where is the cause and where is the result, which is called the effect. So the first one is the cause and the second one is the result. Okay. Can we use it in a different way? Can we rewrite this sentence in a different way where we can put the result at the beginning and the first one at the end? So here we need to play with the conjunctions. So I could say our results would be as precise as possible only if we used accurate recording equipment, or if we used, okay? So these are some examples, okay, of making a causal effect relationships, okay, which has a function of a purpose, okay, or an aim. We call it an aim. So the aim of something, or the purpose, or the target, or the goal. And as you can see, in order to, this is one of the high frequently used conjunctions, okay? Or so that, this is another way we can use it, so that, okay? Another way or another function is consequence. Consequence also is a result. We want to describe results. So I used because here as a conjunction at the beginning, because Hitler failed to respond to the British ultimatum. France and the UK declared war on Germany. So because of something, something happened. So where is the cause, where is the effect? So the cause that has made the result, so this is the cause, Hitler failed to respond to the British ultimatum, okay? And this is what happened. France and the UK declared war in Germany. Is this what you mean? Is this a result of what happened here? Because he failed to respond? Both countries declared a war on Germany? What if I said France and the UK declared war on Germany? Why? Why did they do that? This one? Why did they declare war on Germany? What's the reason? Is it because Hitler failed to respond to the British ultimatum? Yes. This is the cause and this is the effect. So you can understand it this way. See what makes something happen. What's the result and what is the cause of this result? Yes, I know, I understand. That's why I try to explain them. Okay, cause and effects are very tricky. Okay, lots of people confuse using them. The word because and the word because of, okay, let's try to find them here. So because is used here as a consequence, to make a consequence. And because of something, let me give you an example. Let me give you a very simple example just to show you the difference. I succeeded in the exam because of my hard work. So because of my hard work. And here I will say the same sentence. So they both have the same thing, the same meaning, which is the success that I got, and what is this success, how did it came, how I reached my success. So I succeeded in the exam because of my hard work. So here, it's different from because I worked hard. So my hard work here is a dependent clause. I can't say because of I worked hard. Here is an independent clause, okay? And this is what makes the difference. Okay, was it clear? Yeah, who asked the question? Yes, sir. Was it clear now? Excellent. So you have to understand the type of sentences, and this will show you exactly how to use those conjunctions. And that's why I wanted to mention them at the beginning before we move to those details. Where did we stop here? causal effect. Okay, so here we have the final function is the condition. Conditional sentences by using if, only if, otherwise, okay? Example, we qualified survey responses as positive only if the participant selected agree or strongly agree. Otherwise, results were recorded as negative. So this is a condition that I'm trying to put, okay? When I'm trying to analyze a survey from responses. This is a condition that I'm trying to put for myself. So I used only if and otherwise. Otherwise means if this didn't happen, then I will go to the second option here. So I'm trying to make options. So here are some examples, even, only, if, when, provided that, in case, as long as, in that case, unless, given that, otherwise. So these group of words, and there are lots of other words, but just I brought for you some examples, okay, of them. There are lots of examples, okay, for those functions. Okay, finally, this is the last slide, okay, to show the conjunctions types. Expressing sequencing, okay, what it means and what are the functions for that. These transition words indicate a sequence, okay, whether it is the order in the events occurred chronologically or the order you are presenting them in your text. A chronological order, it is an order by time, okay? Something happened, for example, at a specific time, then you are mentioning or trying to tell something at another time, and etc. Okay, if you still remember the sentences that we used to discuss about the UK and France and Germany and what happened, those are chronological orders of events. Okay, so here we have six functions: listing, initiation, continuation, conclusion, report, reopening, and finally a summary. Okay, and each one of those functions have specific words to use. The most common one is listing. This has historically had several consequences. First, look, we used a colon here, and we started with the first thing. First, followed by a comma, the conflict is not given the weight of other conflicts in historical narratives. Full stop. Second, its causes are inadequately understood. Full stop. Third, comma. Then we mention the next, okay, details of the list. So here is one way we list, okay, details. Sometimes you can find writers put them in one sentence if they are, you know, like words or small phrases. Okay, you can put them in one sentence, okay, splitting them with commas and ending with a word or conjunction and. Okay, initiation, for example, to begin with, comma, I want to consider the role played by women in this period. Okay, and these are the examples that you can use to start with something, to begin with. Sometimes we use it at the beginning of paragraphs, to begin with, okay? Then you start telling your readers what you would like to initiate. Continuation, subsequently, okay, so you are continuing something. You are continuing a list. Subsequently, I discuss the way in which the country's various ethnic minorities were affected by the conflict. So before this sentence, there was something else that I mentioned, and now this is a consequence. This is something, okay, a continuing to what I have started. It continues, okay, my previous sentence. For example, we can use also previously, eventually, next, after that, before, then. So these are other words that can be used, okay, to list or to sequence details or information in a text. Also, we can use them for concluding, okay, like for example, finally. Okay, I consider these two themes in combination. Another word that we can use for conclusions is to conclude with, as a final point, at last, eventually, okay, like eventually can be used, okay, either with continuation or with conclusion. In conclusion, also we can use it. Another function is the reopening. You want to reopen another, okay, thought related to what you have mentioned. Reopening something again. So you started with a detail about a topic, okay? There is something you added. You added some information. Then you wanted to go back to discuss the previous, okay, thought. Then you are reopening this thought again. So here you can use these conjunctions. To return to my main argument, it is clear that. Okay, so these are other examples. And finally, we have a summary. Okay, you summarize something. For example, PTAL 2015 comes to a similar conclusion. In summary, okay, the four studies, I discussed four studies here. So the four studies considered here suggest a consensus that the solution is effective. Okay, so this is your concluding sentence that you would like to present your opinion regarding what you have discussed here in the four previous studies. And these are other examples, okay, that has the same function. All right, let's look at the common mistakes with transition words. So these are overused or used incorrectly. So this is one of the main problems. So students use them incorrectly. They wanted to say something, but they used something else. Understand the proper, so what you need to do is to understand the proper usage of transition words and phrases, okay? Don't just depend on your own thought when you read, okay? No, it's good to read about those transition words and to understand their functions, see some examples, what are the words that comes in the same line or in the same list. Okay, so you can understand them, okay, better. Also remember that words with similar meanings do not necessarily work the same way grammatically. Okay, we are considering here the grammatical function of those conjunctions. They could work meaningfully, they could convey the same meaning, but they might not work grammatically. Okay, although they are on the same list. They have the same function, but they are used in different ways. Misused transition words can make your writing unclear. Okay, and we all agree with this. Misrepresenting the connections between your sentences and ideas can make your readers easily lost. Okay, so try to put those advices or tips in mind, okay, when it comes to transition words or conjunctions. There are lots of websites to practice these transition words. Lots of websites, okay? And I'll show you at the end of this lecture some useful websites where you can go and learn about those conjunctions, okay? Okay, confused use of therefore. Some people or writers confuse the use of this conjunction, okay? So therefore and similar cause and effect words are used to state that something is the result of or follows logically from the previous, okay? So make sure not to use these words in a way that indicates illogical connection. So this is what we all always try to focus on when we tell our students about their writing or try to advise them, is that they have to write logically. Their ideas should connect logically, and this is what, okay, makes conjunctions and transition words serve this idea. An example here, we asked participants to rate their satisfaction with their work from 1 to 10. Therefore, the average satisfaction among participants was 7.5. What do you think about this sentence? What does it mean to you? You might understand it in one way, but it means something different. Look at the second. Look at the second one here, okay? The use of therefore in the example is illogical. Why? It suggests that the result of 7.5 follows logically from the question being asked. Okay? When in fact, many other results were possible. So it's not only this result, okay, that we got from this satisfaction survey. Okay, we had lots of results. So using therefore here in this context is not true. It's illogical, okay? Unless if we had only one result, which is impossible. Okay, so to fix this, we simply remove the word therefore. So let's look at the second, okay, edited example here. We ask participants to rate their satisfaction with their work from 1 to 10. The average satisfaction among participants was 7.5. So there is no need to put any conjunctions here because it's already, okay, conveys a clear, meaningful idea. Starting a sentence with also, and, or so, okay? It's typical to see, especially students in elementary, you know, professional level to start sentences with these words. So while the words also and so are used in academic writing, it's okay to find them, but they are too informal when they are used at the beginning of a sentence. So we don't use them at our sentences at the beginning, okay? Otherwise they will be informal. We can use them, I mean, in informal language, okay, especially in our spoken language, but not in academic writing. Example, also a second round of testing was carried out. This is not a good way to write this sentence. Why? Because also here comes as a conjunction in the beginning, which is informal. To fix it, what we can do is either move the transition word to a different point in the sentence or use more formal alternative. Like for example, moreover, we can use moreover or in addition instead of also. Or use it like this, a second round of testing was also carried out. So when we place it here, it's fine. It's okay to use it in the middle of the sentence, but not at the beginning. Also, we can use additionally, replace it with additionally, okay? A second round of testing was carried out. So remember not to use, okay, words like also, and, or so at the beginning of your sentence. Try to place it within the sentence or use something more formal. Creating sentence fragments, okay? Words like although, because are called subordinating conjunctions, which, okay, do not stand alone in their clauses they attach to, okay? There need to be some more information to add to carry on a clear and meaningful sentence. They introduce clauses that cannot stand on their own. They are called dependent clauses. A clause introduced by one of these words should always follow or be followed by another clause in the same sentence. Example, look at the second sentence in the example. It is a fragment because it consists only of the although clause. So here, Smith 2015 argues that the period should be reassessed. Okay, this is a full sentence. But here, although other researchers disagree, then what? So we cannot make a full sentence by saying, although other researchers disagree. This is not a complete thought. So what we need to do here is to fix this sentence by either combining the two sentences using a comma or to use a different transition word like however. And this was edited here. Smith argues that the period should be reassessed, comma, although other researchers disagree, but not as we use the same word, but not as a subordinate clause. Okay. Not like this. We put a comma, then we continue the sentence. Or Smith argues that the period should be reassessed, however, other researchers disagree. Okay. And versus as well as, they are not interchangeable. They have they don't have the same meaning. Okay. Why? Students often use the phrase as well as in place of and, but the meaning is slightly different. Okay. And suggests equal importance of the list. So when you are writing about a list of things, okay, and you use and, it means that all the lists have the same importance. They are equal to each other. But the word as well as, okay, or the phrase as well as, introduces less important additional information. Okay? So the list that comes, or the item that comes after as well as, is not as important as the ones that comes before. So then we use as well as. Okay, let's look at these examples. Chapter 1 discusses some background information on Wolf, as well as presenting my analysis of To the Lighthouse. Okay, the analysis is more important than the background information. So use and or change the word or the order of the sentence to place the most important information first. Okay, so as well as here means that this information you put is not as important as this one. Okay, so here we have an analysis and the background. This is the background and this is the analysis. If I read it this way, it means that this one is not as important as this one, when it is very important. So here we edited this example and we say, we wrote chapter 1 discusses some background information on Wolf and presents my analysis to the lighthouse. So both have the same importance. Chapter 1 presents my analysis of to the lighthouse. I just rephrased the sentence, okay? As well as discussing some background information on Wolf. So I brought the last sentence to the beginning and I used as well as, okay, because this becomes a background. So the analysis is more important than the background. The background is just something to show what has been made on something or what has people thought about an idea. But this one is the most important part. So just switch between them. Note that in fixed phrases like both X and Y, both items, you must use and, not as well as. This one is not true. Both my results as well as my interpretations are presented below. This is not true because both are of the same importance. So what we have to do is to use and, okay, just to make them, okay, have the same importance. Next, using and or. Sometimes we can use and or at the same sentence with a slash. Avoid combining them together in academic writing. It makes your text look messy and is usually unnecessary to your meaning. Okay, consider if you really mean and or, and not just and or. Okay, you have to make sure that what you mean, okay, is this one, not this one. So either or. So both of them are acceptable. If you are certain that you need both, okay, then separate them. How? Participants were asked whether they used the bus and or the train. Participants were asked whether they used the bus, the train, or both. So this one is more acceptable than this one. Okay, the bus, the train, or both. You use it in this way, not this way, okay? Old-fashioned transition words, you can find it in academic writing, but it's recommended and advised to avoid them in your writing. So like here, combining here, there, where, and a preposition such as hereby, therewith, and other are typically old-fashioned styles and must be avoided in modern academic writing. They sometimes make your meaning unclear. For example, poverty is misunderstood as a disease. Hereby, we not only see that it is inherited, but acknowledge its overwhelming effects on a person's health. So these words should usually be replaced with a more explicit phrasing. Explicit gives us an exact meaning. What do you mean by hereby, okay? Expressing how the current statement relates to the preceding one. Because it's not clear, what does the writer mean by hereby? What's the relationship between those two sentences or ideas? So when we edited this one, we say, all right, poverty is best understood as disease. Understanding it as such, we not only see that it is inherited, but also. So I used not only, but also. Okay, acknowledged its overwhelming effects on a person's health. So I inserted this clause, understanding it as such. So I'm trying to explain a meaning here. I'm trying to expand on some information. Okay, then I use these, okay, two conjunctions to make it a little bit clearer than when using hereby. So now I will give you an activity before we end this session. And I want you just to read those two sentences and try to find out which of those conjunctions gives a clear and meaningful sentence, okay? I'll give you 2 minutes to complete those, and then I will take your answers in the chat box. Don't write any answers until I ask you to do so. Go ahead. Okay, now give me your answers in the chat box. So what did you choose for number one? And what did you choose for number two? So number one, then write the answer. And number two, write the answer so I know what you mean. So number one, what is the answer? Whereas, number two, while, okay? So in contrast for number one, and while for number two, do you have the same answer? The team haven't been playing too well, They are expected to win this afternoon. Okay, so here, these are contrasting information. So I used in contrast. These are contrast. So I used in all of them. Okay, gives us a mean. These all of them. Okay, about contrast, but the function is different. Okay, the function here, they are a little bit slightly different. The second one, in nearly every country in the world, they drive on the right. In England, they insist on driving on the left. So here I'm using while. While in nearly every country in the world, they drive on the right. Okay, because this one refers to something I already mentioned. I can't use nevertheless, not in contrast as well. Okay, very good. Most of you answered number two correctly. So let's look at the second one here. I'll give you another 2 minutes. Okay, so number three, to the north, which will remain warm and sunny, the south will become cloudy during the early morning. What did you choose for number three? One. One, okay. On the contrary, to the north. Very good, excellent. The second one, he couldn't get the machine to work following the instructions carefully. Which one did you choose? Most of you say it one, some of you say three. So we have to reach a consensus here. Despite following the instructions carefully, exactly. So it's number one, okay? Very good. Let's look at the last two examples. Just 1 minute, please, before you start typing on your chat box, give your colleagues a time. I'm not tired at all. And look here, we have a comma. I'm feeling full of energy. The computer had recently been repaired. It still kept crashing. So sometimes the structure itself gives you a clue, tells you exactly what you need to or what you can use. So number one is, however, two, one, okay, so let's see. So it's number one. Number five goes with number one. On the contrary, I'm feeling full of energy. Okay. So here, I'm describing what when I said on the contrary. Do you remember? Is it a disagreement, emphasis, concession, dismissal, replacement? You have to make sure what does each one means, okay? The second one is number two. What did you write for number two? What did you choose? Is it although or whereas or in spite of or nevertheless? Although, excellent. Most of you had the same meaning. Very good. Do we still have some exercises? No. Okay. Any questions? This is the end of our
workshop.
And thanks all for your time and listening. And we hope that you have enjoyed and learned a lot.
Yes, it is. Thank you. Thank you for this wonderful, comprehensive, detailed information about transitions and yes, connecting words. Thank you, Brother Yahya, for this wonderful presentation. Thank you all for attending the presentation. So I'm gonna share with you now three links. The first one is the evaluation form. The second one is our YouTube channel. And inshallah, we will upload this presentation within inshallah 24 hours. And the last one is our booking website. So if you need any help with your writing, you can just book an appointment or a couple of appointments. So then you can discuss your issues with one of our writing specialists. So if you have questions or comments, so we still have about 10 minutes because the workshop is 2 hours. So we still have 10 minutes for this, for questions. So if you wanna have a question, just post in the chat or raise your hand or open your mic. Thank you, Brother Yahya.
Thank you so much. I just want to mention something here. For those graduate students who started writing their theses or their dissertations, there is a link here that I will post for you in the chat box, which is very, very interesting. Okay, you could go and you will find lots of details, lots of information about some phrases, some transition phrases and words that you can specifically use in your academic writing. For example, when you are writing research papers, literature review, and or dissertations or theses, okay? You will find lots of information there, okay? Hope you can find it helpful. And thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Dr. Bassem, for taking the floor as a host for this workshop.
Thank you, Mr. Yahya. Okay, so wish you all the best, and wish you, Yahya, and all the attendees the best, and thank you again. So I think we don't have any questions, so then we need to end the session. So thank you again, Brother Yahya. Thank you
so much.
I think the presentation, it is wonderful. A presentation, one of the comprehensive presentation that we have here at the Writing Center. And inshallah,
we will try to post a PDF somewhere so the attendees can refer to back to it.
Yes. Inshallah, we upload it on our website, or they can email us requesting a copy of the presentation, and we'll be happy to send the copy to them. So thank you again. Thank you all. Enjoy the rest of your night.
Can I ask a question?
Is there a question? Yes. Go ahead.
Yes. I want to ask about the attendance. I have been watching all the classes that you gave, and I don't know. I just see it, but I didn't go in a link or something to prove that I attend. Is that okay, or there is a problem?
In terms of getting a certificate or
yes.
Yeah, so you need to complete the evaluation form in order to get the certificate. Otherwise, you are welcome to join the session. And
okay.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if he's asking about an approval that she has attended to give it to someone or.
No, for me.
Just the certificate.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, just complete the evaluation form and inshallah, send the certificate within 24 to 48 hours, inshallah.
Okay, I should do it. I should write my name in the link just once, right?
Yeah, no, we have a separate link for each workshop. So you need to complete. Yeah, you need to complete an evaluation form for every workshop.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome. Okay, I'm gonna leave the Zoom open now and the evaluation form open for a couple more minutes. And thank you all again, and enjoy the rest of your night.
Thank you so much.